Hey everybody, welcome to What Drives Us, episode 221 for March 8th, 2017. My name is Russell Frost. I am from PriusOwnersGroup.com and WhatDrives.us. I'm kind of the man without a country, or maybe the man with too many websites. I forget. But it doesn't matter, because I'm the man with What Drives Us tonight. And luckily enough, I have friends here to help me. And what friends they are, let's introduce them in some random order that will throw Tony off script and make him watch him get nervous. Huh? Oh, see?
Twist.
Off script. It's like, ah! I love Tony. He happens to be our man in Boulder, Colorado. He fixes repairs. He is the ultimate technician of hybrids and EVs at boulderhc.com. His name is still and always Mr. Paul Guzek.
Hey, it's glad to be back. And my beer sponsor this week is the Boulder Beer Company, and drinking something called Mojo IPA. Seems okay. Customer left it for us, so it's got to get drank.
Drunk. You say left it like they forgot it.
That was a tip, a gratuity.
Yeah. Right. He gave it to you, and that was nice of him.
Somebody call up and say, did you find a six-pack lying around? I'm always losing track of my booze.
I did have a customer today return one of our loaner cars and say, there's a bag of marijuana under the passenger seat. Like, I'm sorry. We loan that car to dozens of people a week, and it's Colorado. That can happen.
Wow. Yeah. Oh, man.
like it was something illegal, like a pet.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's like leaving your bottle of water, you know, it's just something they forgot.
Surprised they called.
It's just like normal.
It was a very elderly couple that found. Okay.
48 states, that'll get you in jail. Colorado.
And I said, well, I'll put it in the office, and I'm sure someone will notice it missing and say, hey.
It'll be waiting room pot.
Yeah, that's right. We'll put it in the bin with the junior mints and all that.
Have it next to the Keurig.
A little bowl of M&M's, the decorative bowl of M&M's, and here's like a bag of pot. Just, hey, while you're waiting, roll yourself one.
And a bag of Cheetos. Yeah. Don't forget.
Sure. And some Dr. Pepper. And honestly, this is the longest introduction in the history of this show. So let me introduce our friend, my friend, who, I should say, was kind enough to take time out of his personal work, so it wasn't really personal. I guess it was still kind enough to take time out of his time here in Florida, and I actually got to meet for the very first time our next panelist, Mr. Mark Coughlin.
Yeah, and the first comment I get from Russell is, man, you're tall.
You're tall, dude.
Well, you're always sitting down on the podcast.
So, I'm going to start doing a podcast with my head sticking out,
All I can say is we talk so much. You know what I mean? We've spent a lot of time together.
Yeah.
Hours and hours of time together. And I've developed this image, and I said, here's a guy who's like my height. Maybe he's like 5'8". No. My head comes up to his shoulder.
That was a bit startling. Yeah.
It was, I got over it pretty quickly, I think, didn't I? I handled myself well. Okay. Yeah. So wonderful to meet Mark, and as always, wonderful to have him on the show. And last but not least, our co-host Pro Tem. He is one of the founders of the Chicago Hybrid Group. He's driving a second generation Prius. It's 2017. God love him for that. And he has a new camera this week. Notice those skin tones.
Look,
Mr. Tony Schaefer.
Notice those skin tones, white on white. Look at this. Yeah. Hey everybody. I'm here. So that's about it. I've got yet another Guinness Gold Nail.
You like still haven't gotten rid of that.
I drink about one a week.
You're working through it?
Yeah, I got like half a year.
You know, you could donate it to a good cause if you really hate it that bad.
No, I don't hate it. And this is as good a cause as any.
Leave it in Paul's loner Prius with a bag of pot.
There you go.
Yes.
You know, it's all good. It'll go to a worthy cause. Well, speaking of a worthy cause, let's just get into the show. And as we've redone the show of late, the show starts out with my rant. And my rant this week is one that I've nursed for a very, very long time. I'm sure none of the people watching this go back to like 2005 in the old days when I used to write every day at the priestownersgroup.com. And one of my regular foes was in general the financial press. Now, why does the financial press write about things that aren't really financial? Well, because frankly, after a while, who gives a shit? You know what I mean? Like this disclosure and that disclosure and this CEO and this CFO and blah, blah, blah. And after a while, it just, they want to expand their audience. They want to broaden their base. So they use link bait to get people in. And in the old days, one of the great link baits was anything with a Toyota Prius in it and a hybrid car. That was fantastic link bait. And one of the best, one of the most egregious offenders in this regard is a little investing site called The Motley Fool. I'd hardly call them douchebags because that would imply that they have some utility. There's some usefulness there. Instead, I like to just think of them as bloviating pundits. I have no idea. I can't judge their investment quality information. Maybe it's fantastic. Maybe it's not. I think Patrick Connor's actually taken me to task on this, or maybe that was Seeking Alpha that I was making fun of, but Patrick's defended them. Nonetheless, the Motley Fool has time and time again chimed in on things that I think maybe a little outside of their field of expertise. Like if you hear me talking about college football, change the channel. Just hit pause, go to the skip ahead. I know nothing about college football. If you hear the Motley Fool talking about Chevy Bolt deliveries declining in February, for God's sakes, do not click on the link, okay? Do not click on the link. It is horrible, evil, just tedious. Anyway, Daniel Sparks, who is the senior technology specialist at the Motley Fool, wrote an article that, yes, indeed, in February, Bolt deliveries were down about 200 units. This is the sort of fluctuation that maybe if you're writing either a Chevy Bolt newsletter or you work for GM and you're writing an internal newsletter, probably has significance. But otherwise, I'm going to say that this is a big headline with no delivery whatsoever in the body of the article. The other thing that that tweaked my interest, both of these were published yesterday, and forgive me, Evan, if I've messed up your last name, Evan New, N-I-U, I'm going to guess Evan New. Evan is also the senior technology specialist at the Motley Fool. I guess there's two of them. wrote an article, and the headline of the article is "Repairing My Tesla Model S Has Been an Utter Nightmare." And it's mostly Tesla's fault. So let's break this down just a little bit. And I'm going to put this up on the screen because God knows the Motley Fool needs some. So this is the article. And then there's little Evan there. And there's little Evan's car. And as it turns out, it has been a nightmare. Back in July of 2016, Evan's car was rear-ended while his wife was in it. Thankfully, his wife wasn't hurt, just some minor injuries. But as you can see here on the screen, his Tesla Model S was hurt. It had some damage. The crumple zones crumpled, thus reducing any kind of impact on the passenger, which is the whole point. Evan doesn't take any issue with any of that. In fact, says that the car function as it's supposed to. Now, Evan's a smart guy, and he knows that there's very few body shops that are Tesla certified and that they have a hard time getting parts because guess how many Tesla factories there are?
Hold on. One.
Hold up a finger. Right. So generally speaking, it is not uncommon from what Evan reports that Tesla parts can take 3 or more months. Let me cut to the chase in all of this. It's 7 months and Evan doesn't have his car back. And that's horrible. Okay. Mm-hmm. I will definitely That sucks. It's awful. But in essence, when you buy a car from a startup, I don't really know.
It's still kind of an exotic car. I mean, if this was a Ferrari, it would be the same thing. He'd be waiting for the parts to be built in Italy and shipped over here.
Thank you, Paul, for putting that in context, only because that was sort of the context I was searching for, which is, I feel bad. The guy's been making payments on a car for 7 months, and he makes this point, but he hasn't been able to drive it. That sucks. That's awful. But none of this is a surprise to him. He doesn't express shock or dismay. Well, he's expressed dismay, but not shock. And you know what? In a good world, that car should be fixed by now. Mm-hmm. But it's an utter nightmare, and it's mostly Tesla's fault. And you knew that probably when you bought the car, because you're a smart guy. You're the senior technology specialist at Motley Fool. And he worked briefly at Tesla Motors.
Mm-hmm. You know, I made those two connections as well. And as I was reading through the article, I was reading and I was thinking, okay, this is part, let me tell you the woes that I have experienced. And then it also seemed to me to be part of, wait a minute, I'm writing for Motley Fool. I could tell my story. Thousands of people are going to see this. Tesla's going to hear about it, and they're going to expedite my parts, and they're going to do something for me because that's what they do to avoid bad press. And I got to the very bottom of the article. It said, what this means for investors.
Right.
Yes.
And so then he goes on to bash Tesla, how horrible this is. It calls into question Tesla's ability to support its existing customer base. We're now questioning our Model 3 reservation. And he ends it with 10 stocks we like better than Tesla.
Wait. And this goes back a decade or more. I'm sorry, am I interrupting, Tony?
No, that was it.
Okay. So this goes back a decade or more to the Motley Fool doing things like this. Like, you know, one guy said he didn't get the right MPG in the Prius. So should you buy Toyota stock? You know, and mm-hmm. like in 2006, that was a really, really ridiculous question. This is what they do. I mean, they take a little thing and they make it into a big thing, even though in the end it's a little thing. And I don't mean to minimize his being traumatized by not having his luxury sports car for 7 months, but the other side of it is I don't feel that damn bad for him. I mean,
but I would imagine
if he had good insurance, they at least give him a free loaner car.
45 days.
Yeah. Because as he says, 45 days is usually long enough for a typical car to be repaired.
Well, in a Tesla, not only are replacement parts hard to get because they're not really set up for, it's not like going to the Toyota parts department down the street and ordering a rear deck or something. Spare parts are defined, but the body being aluminum, it is very hard to repair. And it's not just shops have to be certified, but you need a boatload of specialty tools to shape and weld and work with aluminum. And most shops don't have that stuff yet.
So, right. Mm. You know, again,
and similar, if you have a carbon fiber Lamborghini, same thing, only certain people are going to be able to fix it.
Right. Absolutely. Or a Porsche or a Maserati or a Bentley or an Aston Martin or whatever, any of this in that class of car, you know, you certainly spend a lot of money and you expect things to be chop chop. But the truth is, you're probably better off with a Chevy. Because there's a million of those parts out there and they're in a million different distribution centers and they can get them in a few days.
Now, here's something that I said I thought it was really cool that Tesla is doing. And now reading this article, I'm retracting my thought that this was really cool. You know, so you know how they, in the Model S, they dropped that front grill thing and it's just not there anymore. They redid the front.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, so let's say someone is in a front end collision. When they decided to make that change, did they run off 1,000 extra front ends just to save as parts? Or did they just make that change and then now they don't exist anymore?
Generally, automakers would make spares, but I guess we'll see what happens if...
Yeah. Right. See, and that's where I said it was really cool that they don't wait 6 years to do a generational change. They just make a change on the fly But as they're making these little tweaks and these changes, yeah, I mean, the variations in the car models now are going to be ridiculous.
Well, and that's an expense. All the car companies, you know, have to have parts for typically 10 years to service models that they discontinue or alter. There is, though, the resale market. There is a network of junkyards around the country, and if this guy really wanted to find the rear hatch, I'm sure he could find a recycled part somewhere that from a car that got hit in the front and have his body shop.
And on top of that, if the car is popular, like the Tesla Model S, you will have third-party groups that are developing their own to place on cars. There's even kits out there now that if you have a first-generation Tesla Model S, you can get the new front end from this third-party supplier. Mm. So there are some options.
Yeah.
Now, the funny thing about Motley Fool, though, is that, as Russell mentioned, they may not have any reason to talk about a particular technology or car story, but at the end of every article, there's always some sort of stock tip or something about a partner has inside information that you need to click here.
And so, watch the 20-minute video presentation.
Yeah, so they bring it all together regardless. They know where their butter is their bread is buttered.
Yeah.
Right. And they're selling, the problem is they're selling hot air. Again, I don't want to minimize this guy's, you know, poor 7 months without a Tesla Model S life, you know, or that the Chevy Bolt sales plummeted, you know, in February from 1,100 to 900 and something. So, you know, I get it.
Because that 200 Bolt non-sales is going to really affect GM stock price.
Well, and frankly, it's probably more an issue of production and shipping than it is of 200 less people said, nah, I don't want that piece of crap. You know what I mean? It's not, Mark, weren't you the one that did the report that said that all these Bolts are sold? Now it's just waiting for production to catch up and delivery.
Yeah, there has been that report.
And I haven't heard of any discounting yet. I think they're selling it full list.
They're all at full pop pretty well. Yeah.
A Chevy that's not discounted? Hell are me surprised.
Well, it's not a truck. So.
Well, so, you know, my usual big F you to the Motley Fool, just write about stocks, please, for the love of God, just write about stocks and stay out of advanced tech cars. And I will promise not to offer stock information on this show. Okay.
Now, if you do want to read about advanced tech cars and not get bombarded with stock tips, make sure you come to our Facebook page. And that is at facebook.com/whatdrivesus. Leave us comments, suggest news items. Make sure you like the page. Also, if you use Flipboard as your news aggregator, be sure to subscribe to our What Drives Us magazine.
Wow. That was slick, Tony. That was good.
I'm slick, Tony. I'm going into I'll be a used car salesman soon.
You got this new camera. You got like the new script. Well, let's see how you handle this next story.
Well, you're the host this week, so you're the one handing it off to Mark, I'm guessing.
Let's talk about the Charge DV story. I'm sorry, didn't I put that in there? I need to...
I think Tony's up.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, oh, okay. So this was the one I basically said if we, and I think it was a typo in my email, if we can't avoid getting political... It seems every week now since November, we have some political fallout, and we saw this coming. You know, we talked about it, but in Charge DV's article from Charles Morris, who probably doesn't like being called Chuck Morris.
Chuck Morris.
Yes. In Charge DV's, he said strict U.S. auto emission and efficiency standards are history, and recently updated. And he starts the entire article with the words "as expected." Donald Trump, who he refers to as USA's climate change denier in chief, will move towards rolling back federal regulations on vehicle emissions. So the short version of this article is that former President Obama had put in place that car manufacturers need to they're required to meet an average 54.5 miles per gallon by the year 2025. Now, that's going up from 36 where we are today. And of course, he rolled this out and everybody whined and moaned and they said, oh, we can't do it. We don't have the technology. That's why you had all these years to get it done, to figure it out. Instead, they whined and moaned. And when Donald Trump won the election in November, 2 days later, all these car manufacturers went to Donald Trump and said, oh, this is hindering jobs, jobs, make America great again. And so it was expected that he was going to undo all those regulations, which it appears he will be doing very soon. It's already
just planned. After he dismantles the EPA.
Yeah, that's probably step one, dismantle the EPA, and then step two is increase the amount of smog. Now, as though that's not enough. Yeah, see, that's the bonus. Fewer national parks, more emphysema. It's really a win-win. So as though gutting the standards, the car standards, wasn't enough, there's also some verbiage that may take away what they call the waiver from California that allows California to require stricter codes than the federal level. So in essence, you know, you'll no longer have CAFE, right? The California Air Fuel Economy. I forgot what CAFE stands for. CARB. I'm thinking CARB. I'm thinking CARB. Yeah, California Air Regulation Board.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's several things going on here. One is cars are not going to become more efficient. So there's a good chance we'll just see more trucks and Hummers, and a lower push towards developing and incentivizing EVs and hybrids. We're also seeing potentially the reduction of states' rights, which is to say California can't impose stricter regulations. So there's a lot of stuff going on here, and it's just not that good.
Yeah.
Well. Yeah. I'm sorry. Paul, go ahead.
I guess one
thing might happen is he embraces big oil and they start getting greedy and raising the prices again, and then gas goes up, and then the public will start wanting fuel efficient cars.
It'll be interesting to see if, like, that whole law of unintended consequences works against us or works in our favor. I mean, you know, because obviously the stated mission of this administration is going to be to roll back a lot of the changes that have come in over the last 8 years. Anything with Obama's name attached to it is a target.
Right.
I mean, I think they've made that pretty clear. And obviously, you know, putting people like Rex, the CEO of ExxonMobil, in your cabinet kind of sends a message, mm-hmm. sort of, you know.
I think to Paul's point, I mean, you have a really good point. I've read several articles talking about why diamonds are so expensive. And it's not because there's a shortage of diamonds. It's because De Beers literally holds them back and right. convinces you that there's a shortage. And they know exactly where that price point is to make it valuable enough, but not too expensive. And I think the oil people know the exact same thing. They can raise the price and they know where that pain point is, and they'll keep it just below. And they'll string
us
along.
That's what OPEC does. They yeah. lower production to jack up the price and mm-hmm. just tweak it a little bit to get as much as they can and not, you know, hurt financially.
Yeah, exactly.
But as we had said, it, you know, a number of months ago, everybody knew this was coming. Like, this is part of the playbook that we had seen, and we even heard discussed. It wasn't like it was a secret. It was the EPA is holding back jobs. Like, it was just that painfully clear. It's just unfortunate to see it start to roll out.
Yeah. Hey, by the way, for those of you paying attention, CAFE, you heard CAFE standards, is the corporate average fuel economy.
There we go, yeah.
The average fuel economy of one company's cars that they use to set those standards, right?
Right.
And they get like bonus credits if they have a pure EV or a hybrid car.
Right.
And some of those companies sell those credits to other companies who build inefficient cars.
Or Tesla. Hydrogen unicorn.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Read Tesla and Fiat Chrysler. Yeah. Okay. just saying, guys. And yeah, obviously, CARB is the California Resources Board that sets a lot of standards for a lot of
places. Well, they were making good progress. I mean, there was it 10 or 12, maybe more states were adopting the CARB standards, and
And one Canadian sold, province too.
Yeah, had to anybody wanted to sell a car in that state had to comply with the California regulations, which are way more strict than the federal regulations.
Right.
Or so, regulations, for instance, in Kansas.
Yeah.
Or Florida, just
saying. Yeah. So you So you have these people who are saying, you know, smaller government, keep government out of business, and, you know, keep government off my hands, and then telling the states that, you know, you're not allowed to do your own thing. So people who defend, who are sworn to defend the Constitution, and then forget that there's a 10th Amendment.
But that's okay, because all the kids can get emphysema.
Yes. But not healthcare.
Kids are annoying anyway, so. Let's be realistic. On that happy note.
Yeah, there's how's that
going? More kids getting emphysema.
No healthcare to get cured.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no healthcare. Let's quickly move over to Mr. Mark Coughlin, who has something about, wait for it, trucks.
Absolutely.
Rolling coal.
A green truck. Here's a photo of the upcoming workhorse that's being created. This is the W15.
That's correct. It's not a photo. It's a rendering.
Oh, it looks like a photo, Paul.
It looks so real.
Some creative artist did it. I don't think it really exists.
This truck apparently will be debuted at the ACT Expo show in Long Beach, California on May the 2nd. And with that,
made out of fiberboard or styrofoam.
We have a doter in the room.
Our love for concept vehicles just comes through every story like this.
But this article indicates that they've got a 500 order point sent to them from the SCPPA, which is the Southern California utility
Public
group.
Power Authority. Yeah.
Right. So they have ordered 500 of these units. This vehicle, apparently, similar to the Via truck, is going to be strictly for fleets to start, but will be rolling out from that point. So good to see they got a good order. It'll be interesting to see, as mentioned, as to what actually shows up on May the 2nd. The president of the group had indicated that this particular truck, some specifications look pretty, pretty nice. An 80-mile all-electric range, along with a generator, which is made by BMW, by the way, for 310 miles for the extended range.
Oh.
So not shabby at all. It'll be interesting to see if these...
Who's making it? Like this company Workhorse?
You mean who's rendering it?
Yeah. I'm you know, skeptical of stuff like this, but I wish them well, because to build a car from the ground up is billions.
Monumental.
Yeah.
You know, it's not that hard.
Different if they're converting a F-150 Ford or something, but.
But from this.
Yeah, they're not doing that here. This is a ground up build, and good luck with that. As you can see from the photo, they've got, or not photo render. You can see
the sketch. It's got the guy's signature.
It does have a signature on it.
Yeah, you can see in the lower render that it's going to have a front and rear electric motor to give it more pull.
You see, it's not that hard. It only has four parts.
That's it. Yeah.
Yes, it has a front electric motor, an integrated battery pack, which thank God it's integrated. You have a rear electric motor, and then you have an extended crumple zone. That's it. Four parts.
The car only goes straight.
Right.
I'm only goes your screen, Mark, because I'm at the Workhorse website, and the photograph on the front of the Workhorse website is too good not to share. They apparently are also making a UPS step van that launches a drone out of the roof.
Oh, that's awesome. Is the roof retracts?
Yeah. Yep. It's a James Bond vehicle.
Exactly. Like, even NASA would be like, nah, it's too silly.
Is that for the UPS driver? I'm going to hit the video button because I'm bothered to walk up to the porch.
I want to see. There's UPS.
Too good not to show. Oh, yeah.
There's a video. Oh,
please tell me this drone's going to pop out of the roof. Please. Oh, no. Oh,
they're going to park their food truck outside of Wrigley Field and drone you hot dogs in from the outside.
That's the Domino's pizza truck.
She's loading the drone. Why doesn't she just drive to the house?
She's tired. It's been a long day.
Yeah.
I mean, if this was a venture, you know, by Ford or GM or someone, maybe it will work, but I just don't see it.
Making a package. Oh, so she's delivering two packages at once. And there goes the drone.
Off into the farmer's field.
Oh, look at that. And then is the drone going to find her? It'll drop the package in the driveway. They'll run over it.
And then she runs over.
That's a claim. And
there was a company a few years ago called Azure Electric Vehicles or something, and they built electric hybrid step vans.
Right.
And they built about 1,500 of them, and they look pretty cool, and they seem to work. And then they went out of business. And then the van started to break. And then no one could fix them, and they became just doorstops.
Now, is a step van like when your dad trades in the old van for a newer, younger van?
That's delicious. I don't know if they're – watch the video. So apparently they're making eGen step vans. And I know that UPS has bought some of these. There's the BMW W20 Rex engine again.
Yeah.
Oh.
Interesting. Maybe they built some cars, Paul.
The problem is I don't believe it. And then who's going to support them when they go to business?
Right.
Yeah, that's certainly a big problem because you've already spent the money and they disappear and you're left holding the bag.
Right. Oh. I mean, we had one of those Azure vans in our shop and the transmission broke. And we actually had to hire a machinist to make a part for it because you can't buy the parts anywhere for that car. And it was either custom make a part or throw the car away.
Right.
You know.
Right.
And so are these fleet buyers really going to buy from a small startup that may or may not be around in 2 years?
Someone's ponied up 500 orders. I guess they have some confidence, or it's a new fleet manager and he's got no clue.
Right. or
there's some state incentive that makes them essentially free to buy.
Right.
And then, of course, the pricing on that vehicle, the W15, they're guesstimating at $5,250. So $52,500.
Wow.
I mean, that's not that high for a commercial quality vehicle, but.
Yeah.
Still, it's ongoing service and support.
Okay, so just for clarification.
We will certainly keep our eye out for May 2nd and see what happens.
But now I just want to say, wasn't a longtime friend of the show, Bob Lutz, working on electric trucks?
Via. But yeah. Those Via trucks were basically double the price of a regular truck. So they were in the area of 75 plus thousand.
But they were based on a Ford or a Chevy or something that if you needed a wheel bearing, you can go down to Napa and buy one.
That's correct. It was based on a Chevy truck.
Yeah.
So why don't we hear anything? I haven't heard anything lately from.
They're still operating. They're still selling vehicles. And I understand that they're now starting to sell them privately. So they started with fleets as well, but now they're selling privately. But you're right. It's pretty quiet. You're not hearing much.
I wonder how many they've sold.
Yeah. That might be the reason it's quiet.
Yeah.
God, Bob Lutz is listed as the founder of Via.
Ooh. I like his coffee.
I feel dirty even just visiting the site. Vehicles. They have beat trucks and van.
Do you have to wash your keyboard now?
No, I'm not. Believe me. Bob doesn't do that for me.
No, I mean like when you shake hands with a car salesman.
Yeah, exactly. You know. No, I might have to wipe off the screen or something, but that's
from the inside.
The only way to go. Well, let's move on to something else. You know, Paul, I love having you on the show because you do think of these like I wouldn't have thought to bring up damn wheel bearings. But that's an absolutely critical concern. Like, even if all the technology works forever, if a stupid wheel bearing goes out and it was custom made or bought from some factory in Finland that's gone, right, you're screwed.
Yep.
You're screwed.
A lot of parts in a car, even electric car, as simple as they are, there's still a lot of stuff that can break and wear out.
Yeah. No, that's brilliant, dude. Thanks. Well, let's go to Tony. For the next story.
Which about one? Panasonic?
About Panasonic.
About Panasonic. So this is just a flyby. It's nothing too great. It's just a quick little article that Panasonic apparently has developed a solar car roof for the Prius. Now, I realize it's 2017. I realize that the first generation plug-in Prius also had a solar car roof. So this is not really something that's earth-shattering. Except, big difference is, this is a different solar roof. So whereas the previous one, what is it, 90 watts, 80 watts?
60.
It was 60, yeah. Okay. So yeah, it was only a 60-watt solar roof. I was trying to find it. Yeah, it was really only powerful enough to generate the automatic cooling with cooling system. It really just ran the fans in case the car got really hot.
Air conditioning. It was just a ventilation fan.
Right.
Exactly. Right. Yeah. It wasn't even air conditioning. It was.
So you're referring to it as passive cooling, which meant there's a fan that draws exterior air and passes it through the vehicle.
Where if you crack the window half an inch, it would do the same thing.
Kinda.
Now, I might take issue with that, but
so this one is 180 watts. And still doesn't provide a lot of oomph, according to the article. But Toyota says it could increase the efficiency up to 10%, or, in other words, adding maybe 2.2 miles per day in ideal conditions. 2.2 miles isn't that much, but, as with a lot of the tech that we talk about, it's a start, it's a proof of concept, it's something.
Unless you park in a garage.
Right. Yes.
Or under a tree.
And that was ideal conditions, of course.
Yeah. I think people still don't really grasp how much square footage you have to have.
A lot of real estate for solar to be efficient.
Yeah. Right. The roof of a car is not, in our lifetime, probably ever going to be a significant generator of power.
But I do have to say, as Tony mentioned, it is a start. Like, they went from 60 to 180. Mm-hmm. Who knows, over time, there may be other breakthroughs that could push it to 240 or maybe, 500 at some point in the future. Well, but that is something that you have to work on in order to get there.
And I think there are also support systems and whatnot that might be taken out. If these solar panels can augment the batteries, I actually really use the passive cooling system a lot, and I found it to be very helpful in reducing the air conditioning that I had to use, in not having the car just be searing hot when I got into it. So I like the passive cooling thing. I thought it was cool. Now, was it worth whatever I paid for it? Oh, hell no. You know what I mean? Like, I paid a lot of money for that advanced tech package with the solar roof and the solar panels on the roof and the fan, but it was cool. And again, like everyone has said, as a proof of concept, is what can we run with this power? What would be the best thing to run? I think that's a wonderful thing.
There are some drawbacks to the current implementation. It's reinforced glass sheeting hasn't yet passed rollover crash tests in the US. It's only an option available in Japan and Europe right now. And also, if you guys read down to the bottom, it estimated cost about $1,800. And for $1,800, you get to give up heads-up display, blind spot monitoring, and rear cross-traffic alert. Now, I don't see the connection. Can you explain that to me?
Why are those things connected? Yeah. Wait.
Paul, why?
Yeah, I guess weight is probably one.
Well, but once Toyota has sold the car, you know what I mean? Or is this something that they install?
Maybe they take away all that stuff that costs money, and it's that you would still pay that amount plus $1,800 premium.
Okay, I was thinking this was like an after thing. Okay,
I know that on the third gen, because I had this, there were some options that I couldn't get, and I was told at the time from Toyota that this was a weight, primarily a weight issue. Now, whether or not that was just some specious thing they were throwing at me to shut me up or not, I don't know. But it was a matter of the vehicle had certain weight parameters, and that solar roof added weight, so they had to take something else off.
Well, it's not necessarily the weight that it added. The fact that it wasn't structural steel meant they had to add more steel underneath to make the car safe, which added a lot of weight to the car.
I think, yeah, and honestly, if somebody said, would you rather have those safety features or would you rather have the solar roof? I'm going to tell you right now, I love the blind spot monitoring, the cross traffic sensors. Yeah. All of that stuff is very, very cool.
Yeah.
But and in a related type story, the Tesla forums are talking about that since they've got that connection with Panasonic and their batteries, the thought is that that same solar roof or some version of it may come to the Model 3. So there's been some discussion about that as well.
But in Tesla's option, it will be a $4,500 option.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, this goes back to something else, too, that in my review, the upcoming, folks, review of the Prius Prime, I think an issue with weight and the way Toyota has engineered this vehicle, it's a little underpowered. And I don't mean like if you're just in the car by yourself driving around, you probably would never, ever notice this. But God forbid you're carrying some Lake Michigan bags of sand in the back or people or pets.
Or four average Americans.
Four average Americans. I want to tell you, the car gets piggy quick. Right. It's not, it kind of acts like an obstinate child. That's a shame because I hope in the next iteration of this Toyota works on that and gives it a little more power, a little more oomph. And I've never been the guy who's like, I want the Prius to drive like a sports car. That's not, I mean, yeah, that'd be cool, but that's not been where I'm coming from here. I think they're cutting it too close.
And even if you press power mode, it's still sluggish.
Yeah. Yeah. With four people in the car. Yes. Yeah. By myself. No, I had a hell of a time by myself. Right. It was great. But with four adults in the car, it was like, well, three adults and a six-year-old. Okay. And she's not like 6 foot tall. So, yeah, I was kind of surprised. I was kind of, maybe I shouldn't be like previewing my review this early, but I guess it's my show, so I shouldn't stop talking. Tony, thank you for the solar roof on the Prime. And it'll be interesting to see how that comes out. I mean,
or if it even comes to the States.
Yeah. Someone in the chat room suggested the solar roof is Japan. Bruce, I don't know how to say Bruce's last name. Bruce, whose last name I don't know how to say properly, suggested it's only sold in Japan, which I seem to recall hearing.
Yeah, Japan and Europe.
Japan and Europe. Okay, so not even in the U.S. And again, that goes back to crash testing.
And I'm guessing not other parts of Asia, or they would have spelled that out.
Yeah, or maybe not, who knows. But hey, Bruce, thank you for that. I appreciate that. This is why I should read the chat every week. Speaking of what I should do every week, Paul has a story next about... Well, I'll let Paul.
Yeah, another stupid company doing stupid hydrogen cars. Regular listeners to the show will know we're not a big fan of anything hydrogen-powered and can... listen to the archives for why, but now Hyundai's previewing next year's hydrogen-powered SUV. Whoop-de-doo. You know, it's a car with great engineering and great technology, but no practical application in this society. yeah. It's just nowhere to put fuel in it. You know, and stupid stuff. I mean, reading the article, and we'll post a link, an internal air humidifier recycles some of those water emissions inside the car's cabin's atmosphere. So instead of pissing on daisies, you know, they're recycling. I don't know.
It humidifies.
Maybe more companies should listen to our show and realize that hydrogen is stupid.
Well, and this is a concept. I mean, you know, really, everything that's in here that talks about what the car is and what the car does came right off of printed marketing material, which is a dime a dozen.
And it will go 500 miles on a full tank of hydrogen. Yeah. And how many places can you fill that vehicle?
Right.
that the distance of 500 miles was decided upon because that is approximately the distance between hydrogen fueling stations.
Oh, and in the trunk, it's built to stow an electric scooter to help you go the last mile. That means when you run out of hydrogen and there's no fueling station within 8,000 miles, you can ride your scooter home.
You go for help on the scooter.
Yeah. See people walking down this, walking along the highway with their hydrogen bucket.
Yeah. On their scooter.
Spare a gallon of hydrogen?
Yeah.
Knocking on neighbors' doors. That would be fun.
Uh-huh.
Are we missing something? Should we be respecting this for some reason?
No.
No.
I just. Yeah. FE stands for Future Eco. The Hyundai FE fuel cell.
I mean, it has some kind of cool looking wheels, depending on your preference.
Concept. I mean, in the headlights, what the hell is that?
Very the taillights are kind of wavy gravy.
Yeah. We showed those a minute ago while you were talking, Paul. I showed all angles of the vehicle. So.
But, I mean, first of all, we don't believe any concept thing.
Mm-hmm.
And second of all, hydrogen is dead before it even started.
Now, I notice on the back, on that back view below the H in that area, it looks like they misspelled idiot.
That's good. Why doesn't I mean, you know, well known for his sense of humor, and I'm not being mean to him here, but why doesn't somebody like Elon Musk come up with just like announce the Model 6 cold fusion powered,
right,
unlimited range electric vehicle. We'll go 7,000 miles an hour.
On Winston banana peels.
Yeah.
Yeah.
With the option of Mr. Fusion.
Yeah. It just sucks atoms out of the air. You know, I mean, that's
right. Right.
Why not? Like, what's the difference between that and this?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, Hyundai had a better marketing budget for rendering than the last company, you know. And they actually have an actual real sort of car concept that's probably not styrofoam, but
although you can't get up on stage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can't get on stage, you can't touch it, and you know, every concept has to have suicide doors.
Yeah. That's the 2017 thing.
The rule
requirement.
Yeah.
And the blue nightclub lighting on the inside.
Right.
The suicide door that never makes it to, you know, whatever. Well,
I do like the scooter idea to get home, you know.
Mm-hmm. And actually, they've incorporated the scooter in another vehicle that's electric, which makes even more sense because some people leave the car to charge a little bit longer and hop on the scooter to go the last mile and then come back and get the car when it's charged.
But you know what? There's tens of millions of places you can charge an electric car in this country. There's maybe 10 places to charge a hydrogen car.
And one state.
Yeah.
Well, and four of them are open. I actually think there's like a few dozen, but like four of them are open and have hydrogen.
Yeah, half of them are broken at any given time.
Yeah, they should have outlets in the back to charge your electric scooter off the hydrogen so that you use a ridiculous amount of electricity to strip the water molecules apart and then transport them and then pump them and then reconvert them to charge the battery for further diminishes to power the scooter.
But hang on, why not just plug the scooter in the wall?
No, you're missing the point. Hydrogen. It's hydrogen, Paul.
That's right.
It's the future.
That's like plugging your Chevy Volt into your Hummer's ash cigarette lighter.
Yeah, there it is.
That's all you need to do.
Yeah,
exactly. It's perpetual motion.
That's right.
Why don't they just drag the scooter and put it in regen mode and then, oh no. That's probably
there was a, I sometimes play on Quora.com. It's kind of like a Reddit. Some guy said, why don't electric cars just generate electricity going down the road with their generator? And after I politely said, well, can't really do that, I said, for those of you who were asleep in high school physics,
there is no perpetual motion machine.
Yes. Patrick Hunter reminded us of the thorium car. Remember that?
Yeah. Well, thorium in a large-scale reactor may have some promise, but not in a car.
Not in a car. And honestly, do I want a reactor in my car? I mean, you know, like a gas tank, a hydrogen tank. That's, do I honestly...
is 100 times safer than uranium, but...
100 times safer, which is easily the deadliest substance on the planet.
Right.
Right. So
it'll take you 100 more seconds to die.
Yeah.
That's exactly.
You get the field a little longer. Yeah.
After just looking at a story where we see the back of a Tesla smashed in, do you really want a reactor sitting in your car?
Yeah. Instead of like one picogram of plutonium killing you in seconds, it takes like what, a milligram of thorium to kill you in 10 seconds. I feel so much safer. Yep. Well, you know, I always start out the show with like the angry thing, and that's okay because that's who I am. I mean, I admit it. I have some anger management issues, but I've commandeered Tony's feature at the end of the show because I love it so much, and I have a really for me this is a great story to share. So you know, I lived sort of a nomadic existence as a child, and I did. My high school years and a lot of time as an adult in San Diego County. Oddly enough, a small community called Escondido, California, in North San Diego County. And oddly enough, Escondido, California was all over the news. Okay, I'm sorry, no one's seen this but me. But, you know, I have more news alerts than you do. But they should have been all over the news. Why? Why, you ask? SDG&E, which is a San Diego Gas and Electric Company, the utility in San Diego County, announced the opening of the world's largest lithium-ion grid-attached storage facility in Escondido, California.
Yeah. So it's like a giant power wall?
Of all places, in Escondido, California. Why? Why not in beautiful San Diego or who knows? There's so many other places.
Cheap rent for the land that they put these boxes on?
You know, it's not that cheap, to be honest with you. I have no idea. I know this part of town. It's right by the light industrial part of town. It's right off of I-15 at Valley Parkway, in between Valley Parkway and 9th, for those of you who are locals. Anyway, it's a 30-megawatt facility with 120-megawatt max storage capacity. And obviously, this is a big deal. California's had some issues back in the old bad Bush days. You know, there was the whole Enron energy speculating thing where Californians had issues with rolling blackouts and things like that. Things that a grid-attached storage could help ameliorate, could help lessen.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's great.
We've talked extensively on the show about decentralizing the grid, about battery storage in people's homes, in commercial businesses, and obviously even in a municipality, to have the ability to say, you know, we have this certain extra safety measure now, this buffer built in. I think it's fantastic. I mean, I'm really excited. And of course, you know, just again, because it was in Escondido.
And, you know, certainly as, you know, as it says in here that, you know, large scale utilities have usually shied away from these big storage centers, but the cost of batteries and large scale storage has come down. And, you know, most utilities can handle about 90% of the busiest day of the year. That's just how they're sized. And then what they have, what are called booster plants, that they kick in to make up the difference. The idea being you would run your regular plant, you know, maybe controlling how much output you do during the year. And then as it starts maxing out, you bring these booster plants online. the booster plants are usually powered by something like diesel or, you know, oil of some kind, you know, an easily storable, usable fuel. Having something like this, a 30 megawatt, you know, like you said, up to 120, could easily replace one of these booster plants, or two or three of them spread in different places around the grid.
Right. And again, we're talking about lithium ion batteries, which, while if made by Samsung, may explode spontaneously, you know, are relatively safe. This isn't something that's going to be leaking PCBs or, you know, this is relatively benign technology, and it's not even super high tech. I mean, you know, these 18650 battery farms are, it's just crazy. So, you know, I mean, there's no reason why all sorts of communities couldn't invest in these, again, to ensure their citizens, you know, access to electrical power.
Yeah.
In a responsible manner.
In a responsible, and, you know, so much the better if, and again, you know, real estate in Escondido isn't cheap. It's cheaper than San Diego, maybe, but not by much. Even better if these things are attached to a solar farm or to wind, to wind turbines, where they're actually generating the energy for the battery farm in a sustainable manner. This right now is just pulling energy off the grid and storing it there in case of an emergency. But you can't. You got to build one part. This is a, you know, one way to start. So cheers to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I'm kind of staggered because for most of my life, I've had nothing but evil things to say about San Diego Gas and Electric. And here I am, like, doing a feature on them. So there we go.
At the end of the show compared to the beginning of the show.
Yeah, no, I'm happy. And I got to say Escondido several times. For no good reason. I mean, now you guys know that there is a city in North San Diego County called Escondido.
I always wondered about that.
Have you really?
Just was never Googled
it. In the 80s, like Escondido Man? Or?
No.
Yeah, I think it was Brandon Fraser.
Right. That's it. I'm out of here. As soon as you guys say I'm a Pauly Shore, I'm done. Okay? That's it. No, it's not Encino, and it's a different place. Did you really think that? But of course, right? Like, you're not from there. You're just, I'm going to be good now. Let's see, Tony, where we got here? Tony's story of the week. So then I've got to do a Priest Chat commercial. So I should read the script, and I'm going to do that.
Okay.
Is there something you'd like to do, Tony?
No, it's just, I guess all three of these articles are the Escondino.
Yes, sir. Part. Just okay. Different views. That's all.
Yeah.
Okay. No, I didn't have three stories to finish up with. That would be, I mean, I'm self-indulgent, but Jesus, not that self-indulgent. Well, maybe that. Anyway, hey, if you want a Prius and you need accessories or fun stuff for your car, be sure to visit the Prius shop for all your accessory needs. You can find it at PriusChat.com/shop. That's PriusChat.com/shop. Every item sold at the Prius shop has been inspected and tested by Prius owners. Before I move on to Tony's next plug, I also want to say next week, March 15th, you want to be here. You want to be watching our show because we have an amazingly cool show for you. We have three special guests. Should we say who they are? Yes, we should. Ed Niedermeyer, who we've had on before. What did we say about Ed? Ed's an auto writer. He writes a daily Kanban. He's written.
We can call him an EV enthusiast.
He's definitely an EV enthusiast. Yeah. He's written some things critical of Tesla. He's taken Tesla to task. But what he says is that because he loves Tesla and he wants them to be better, he wants to point out their faults. He's not just a critic or, he's not there to undermine them. Opinion may differ. That's one take. Right. Ed is bringing along his friend Alex Roy. Alex Roy was one of the people who did the world record Tesla cross country drive, one of the drivers, which is really cool. And that's fun. And that's great. But even more cool, dude has run the Gumball Rally like half a dozen times.
Isn't that illegal?
You know what? We're not here. Do I look like a lawyer? Do I look like a lawyer? All I know is, dude has balls. Okay. So Alex Roy, and finally Matthew Teske. Now Matthew Teske, you may remember from last year, a story that we did about a guy, a crazy guy who set up a fun fan site for a fictional car until the car company came down on him like a ton of bricks. Matthew Teske was the designer of the Chevy Jolt electric sports car site. And you're wondering, what do these people have in common? Well, what we want to do is have a show about car fans and talk about what fans do and how they infect the companies that they're fans of and how good and bad the companies interact with their fans. I think we've got some good people. We even may have, believe it or not, this guy named Danny Cooper, who runs one of the biggest Prius sites on the planet. It's amazing.
I heard he's a mythical creature. Does he?
Like hydrogen fueling stations.
He's not harvesting hydrogen.
Opinions may differ, yes. So next week, March 15th, Wednesday, 9 p.m. live, or of course you can watch it at whatdrives.us anytime you like in audio or video format. I would love to see if you have questions, if you want to post stuff on the Facebook page at facebook.com/whatdrivesus. We would love to see that there too. Right. Tony, I'm sorry. I've rambled on and on and on.
No, that's all right. You know, I don't know where you got this episode. If it's the first time you're listening to it, maybe you got it from Stitcher, Slacker, YouTube, Google Play, or iTunes. Make sure and go back, subscribe, and you'll never miss an episode moving forward, even whether it is a really cool one like next week's or just a normal, boring one like this one.
Wait.
And all the archives. I mean, there's a few bunch of years of shows from the past.
Right, and that's Russell's What Drives Us main site plug that he's about to do.
Boring. be sure to visit us on the main site. That's whatdrives.us. Once again, whatdrives.us. What Drives Us. Get it? It's clever. We post every show in audio video form for streaming or downloading. Also at whatdrives.us, we post articles and reviews from the experts you see here, right here. Want to learn how to drive more efficiently? Tony Schaefer. It's there at whatdrives.us. Go there. Our complete archives, as Paul said, are there. What else, Tony?
Yeah. So we want to thank our panel for being on the show. Thanks, guys. We want to thank all of our listeners and the ones in the chat room. So as always, we want to thank Michael Mannering for the theme music. You can visit him at manthing.com. Watch a lot of his amazing videos on YouTube.
There you go. You know, we didn't get a chance to plug for the plug. So, Paul, tell everybody where they can find you.
Well, I'm still in Boulder, Colorado. So anybody has a plug-in car, an EV, a hybrid, we can service it. We probably won't be able to service your hydrogen car, but you probably won't be able to get here in your hydrogen car. So, call us if you're in the region and have a hybrid problem.
What is it? I heard Boulder had one of the largest unicorn petting farms in the United States.
Yes. Alpaca.
Alpaca.
Yeah.
Mark Coughlin.
Just say hello to the Waterloo Regional Voltec Group and look forward to next week's show.
Absolutely. Tony Schaefer, anything to plug?
No, I want to just go through like Lee Moon and Bruce and Jan and Patrick C and Austin. Good to see you again. JT24. Who'd I miss? Lee's on here. As always, shout out to everybody who helps, keep us going.
Absolutely. I love the chat. I wish I wasn't so distracted. You know, like
too many things to do.
Right.
Too many things to do, but I would be in there being a smartass more. And watching the delayed video really freaks me out because it's like, wait a second, I just saw myself do that, and then like 30, it's too much. It's like Back to the Future.
You can pause the video, you know.
Can you?
Yeah.
Oh my God!
We're figuring this out live.
Oh my God, we are working this out live. Yeah, there you go. So yep. You guys in the chat keep suggesting titles for the show. I'm not really sure where I'm at yet. Sniffing hydrogen's good, but maybe we'll see.
Kool-Aid?
I'm sorry?
Hydrogen Kool-Aid?
Oh.
Drinking the Kool-Aid?
Oh. Hydrogen Kool-Aid, I like.
Yeah.
I like.
As long as it's blue.
Yeah.
I think it'd be a pretty light blue. Baby blue. Because hydrogen should be baby blue. Simple, I guess. I want to thank Paul Guzik, Tony Schaefer, Mark Coughlin for being on the show this week. Thank you guys for helping make not a boring show, a great show. Don't listen to Tony Schaefer's rap calling the show boring. Next week, though, is going to be an amazing show. If nothing else, just to what I don't, well, I won't say that. I was gonna start controversy, but I'm not gonna. We're gonna have great guests. We're gonna have a lot of good talk, and come along and participate in the chat. That's it for this week. Download us next week and find out what drives us. Thank you, one and all. Thank you, what drives us. Good night.